Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another webinar from the Malaysian Obstetric Medicine Society. Ladies and gentlemen, I think it is extremely important to talk and to address a topic which I think is extremely relevant and important now, the safety of COVID-19 vaccination and boosters in pregnancy. What is the evidence and should we be giving and advocating boosters pregnant mothers? This is a topic which is of interest, but I'd like to highlight that I've got no conflict of interest in this talk. Ladies and gentlemen, in the next 30 minutes, I would like to highlight three key facts. COVID-19 and pregnancy, what are the implications? The importance of vaccination in pregnancy, the safety, and how we should move forward by advocating boosters for pregnant mothers and why. Let's first take a look at the implications of COVID-19 in pregnancy. Ladies and gentlemen, what has history taught us about infections in pregnancy? Let us just reflect and go back one decade in time. Let's take a look at 2011. Let's learn from the previous pandemic, H1N1. There were a significant number of women who died from respiratory causes. And the maternal death was highest from H1N1 pneumonia. And that we know that firstly, pregnant mothers are more susceptible to respiratory infections, especially in the second and third trimester. Secondly, we highlighted and appreciated the importance of vaccinating pregnant mothers for influenza and now for COVID pneumonia. So ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we often fail to reflect on history, but it is a known fact that if a pregnant mother gets an infection, she tends to be more severe, namely for three reasons: the respiratory adaptations, the cardiovascular adaptations, and most importantly, the change in her immunity. So ladies and gentlemen, let's take a look at some hard facts. There were 148,327 women who screened positive in US. The deaths were low. The deaths were 0.016%. In UK, they did not have a policy of universal screening. They only screened symptomatic mothers, but they had one of the lowest deaths in Europe, 14 deaths, an incidence of 0.4%. Malaysia, on the other hand, we had 10 times less infected mothers. Our deaths were 184. This gives a death rate of 1.27%. It means if you're pregnant, if you have COVID-19, the incidence of dying is higher as compared to one who's not pregnant, as compared to the general population, and hence, pregnant mothers are vulnerable. So ladies and gentlemen, I think in the early days, when the infection was still limited to Wuhan, we were actually deviated to perceive and to believe that pregnant mothers were well. However, I'm going to prove to you that this original science and data was not true. We were made to believe that most of the pregnant mothers were asymptomatic, most of the pregnant mothers were mild. However, it only took us a few months. And this wonderful paper, a living systematic review and meta-analysis from the BMJ, highlighted some truth about the implications of COVID-19. Now, this paper is constantly being updated. The last update was just a few months ago. It's one of the largest living registry looking into pregnant mothers, women of the reproductive age group. It is a wonderful registry with a significant number of patients. And what do we know now? Ladies and gentlemen, if a pregnant mother has COVID, the mortality is increased. The need for ICU admissions are increased. Stillbirths are increased. Neonatal deaths are increased. Neonatal admissions are increased and fetal heart rate abnormalities and fetal distresses are increased. And those are the conclusions of a large living systematic review. If you're not a fan of BMJ, another paper in the European Journal also which looked into systematic review and meta-analysis of pregnancy outcomes, showed similar findings. This paper also showed that if a mother gets COVID-19 infection, her need for oxygen support is increased. The need for mechanical ventilation is increased. Caesarean section, iatrogenic preterm delivery to aid the mother's respiration, fetal heart rate are increased. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to bring your attention to another paper published by the Zambrano, who compared symptomatic pregnant women with COVID-19 as compared to symptomatic non-pregnant mothers. And incidentally, they realized if you are pregnant, ICU admissions are higher. If you are pregnant, the need for ventilation is higher, the need for ECMO is higher. But most importantly, if you are pregnant, the incidence of death, which is 1.27% in Malaysia, is increased 1.7-fold in this cohort. Now, which of the variants was significant? There were zero maternal deaths in the first wave of Malaysia, perhaps it was the alpha and the beta strand. But a second wave had significant implications in Malaysia. There were a total of 184 mothers who died in the second wave, with a peak of August 2021. Similarly, based on the ICNAC report in UK, the implications of the second wave, perhaps the Delta strain, was far greater than the first wave from the alpha and beta strain. And now we know that a pregnant mother is infected with a Delta variant, the incidence of ICU admissions, 1 in 7, far higher than 1 in 10 in the alpha variant. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to bring your attention to another large cohort and registry about pregnant mothers with COVID-19. It is called the Pregnancy COVID-19 Registry of PREGTOF. Now, this has been initiated by the University of Birmingham. It's one of the largest registry to study pregnant mothers. And they also showed that if a pregnant mother's got COVID-19, preterm birth is increased. Iatrogenic preterm birth to deliver the mother for the mother's safety. And the incidence of stillbirth is also increased. So, another point, if a mother's got COVID-19, does that increase the risk of infection in the baby? Yes. Based on this paper, which evaluated 25,000 women, the incidence of the baby being infected is 1 to 2%. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the science is clear that we now understand that COVID is not transmitted via the vertical route. However, the risk of transmission is possible via respiratory droplets or direct contact, and has been postulated to be around the range of 1 to 2%. Hence, it's not only the mother who's at risk, it is not only the mother who's infected, but it's also her newborn baby. So other publications also showed similar outcomes. A study based on a cohort in California showed similar maternal outcomes. A study looking into US academic centers during the pandemic showed similar implications to the mother. A study looking into the inter-COVID multinational cohort study showed similar outcomes. The recent CDC paper just published October 2020 also showed similar outcomes that pregnant mothers are vulnerable. The risk for the mother and for the fetus is increased if the mother's got COVID-19. Let's come back to Malaysia. Let's take a look at our own confidential inquiry data. Based on the data up till November 2021, there were 44% of maternal deaths due to COVID-19. That means 44% of mothers in Malaysia died due to COVID-19 from the overall mothers. 60% of them were in the third trimester. Sadly, there were two times more mothers who died in 2022 from COVID-19 as compared to the national average. And these numbers, ladies and gentlemen, are extremely significant. It is not just the life of the mothers who were lost, it is also tragic that the life of the babies were also inadvertently lost as well. So let's take a look at the timing of deaths, majority in the third trimester. But the second trimester, one third of them actually died in the second trimester. And hence, if you were to have a policy to quarantine pregnant mothers, you should start in the second trimester. One third of them were vulnerable. And this tallies with your physiological adaptations of a pregnant mother. Now, interestingly, 66% of them required a delivery to aid mechanical ventilation. Hence, they had to be delivered prematurely. Now, it is often a norm that the moment you talk about COVID-19, we always ask, are they low risk, are they high risk? Yes, 78% of them had comorbidities. Obesity seems to be one common cause, which is across the board. 75% of them were obese. But I'd like to bring your attention to age. Ladies and gentlemen, COVID-19 is not just a disease which affects men. It's not just a disease of the elderly. Now, based on the Malaysian CEMD report, 60% of mothers who died in Malaysia were young, below the age of 35. So you should have a policy of vaccinating every single pregnant mother, not just pregnant mother at an advanced age. And hence, we should also be giving them booster, a point which I will justify in the next few minutes. So ladies and gentlemen, to summarize the implications of COVID-19 in pregnancy, pregnant mothers are vulnerable. 1 in 7 mothers needed ICU admissions, especially from the Delta strain. If you're pregnant, the risk of ventilation, the risk of death is increased as compared to a non-pregnant mother. The fetal risk includes preterm, stillbirth, neonatal deaths, and cesarean section. And if the mother is positive, there's a small chance that the baby may also be positive, not through the vertical route, but through direct contact. Hence, it's important to vaccinate pregnant mothers to protect the mother and to protect the baby. Let's take a look at the Malaysian story. We first started the vaccination program focusing on frontliners. And we started in February and April 2021. Next, we started the vaccination program in phase 2 only for high-risk pregnant mothers. But ladies and gentlemen, as early as July and August, we realized that all pregnant mothers needs to be vaccinated, not just those with high risk. 60% of them were young. So we started a policy to vaccinate almost all pregnant mothers. In August, it peaked. It is because of a death of a celebrity. But we achieved almost 90% of pregnant mothers of the adult population were vaccinated. And in October, we quickly came out with a guideline recommending boosters for pregnant mothers. Malaysia is one of the countries in the forefront recommending boosters for pregnant mothers. I'm extremely proud and passionate to be involved in these guidelines. So let's take a look at the US registry. One of the largest documented registries in the world is the VSAFE registry. And as of now, as of few days ago, 177,736 women have been vaccinated in US. And 6,685 women have been enrolled in the study. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to share an important fact that Malaysia, we've almost reached the vaccination levels in US. We have vaccinated 176,761 women. We've achieved a vaccination rate of almost 90%. If you take a look at the US cohort, the uptake among pregnant mothers remains low. The coverage is only about 30%. But in Malaysia, what changed was the death of a celebrity. But I believe we have done really well to focus on this vulnerable group. So ladies and gentlemen, now we can appreciate the implications of COVID-19, the importance of vaccination. Is it effective? I'd like to bring your attention to this paper published by Dagan et al., who looked into the effectiveness of the mRNA vaccine in patients with breakthrough infections. Breakthrough infections are infections following a vaccination. And they compared two cohorts of people. The incidence of COVID-19 among the unvaccinated and the incidence of COVID-19 among those who were vaccinated. And interestingly, ladies and gentlemen, the severity of the disease, the risk of infection and being symptomatic is far reduced if someone had the vaccine in pregnancy. It is efficacious. Similarly, a recent JAMA paper by Goldstein also looked into breakthrough infections among vaccinated population, and they found out similar outcomes. Your risk of breakthrough infections is significantly reduced in the vaccinated group as compared to the unvaccinated group. The RCOG came out with a very strong statement, and they said that no pregnant woman who have ever been vaccinated were actually admitted to the hospital. And this was a statement produced by the RCOG in September 2021. Was that true in Malaysia? Let me share with you all some data. Among the 184 mothers who had a direct death from COVID-19, 79% of them were unvaccinated. 19% of them did not complete their schedule as only they had one dose, but only 2% in the vaccination group actually died. And among the 2%, 66% of them had Sinovac. So ladies and gentlemen, this proves one fact. Vaccination is effective in reducing maternal deaths. It is not 100% foolproof, but it works in reducing maternal deaths and reducing maternal mortality. The next brings to the next question. Are these vaccines safe? Having appreciated the importance of vaccinating, the efficacy of vaccination. So one of the first studies that proved that the vaccines were safe was based on the V-Safe registry published in June 2021. And this showed that by using the mRNA vaccines, there were no safety concerns, and it was not associated with adverse pregnancy outcomes. Interestingly, the same V-Safe study was extrapolated and published later on, looking into the timing of the vaccination to see if it causes miscarriage, a common misconception that a vaccine causes miscarriage. Now, interestingly, ladies and gentlemen, based on this New England Journal of Medicine paper, the vaccine was not associated with miscarriage taken at any gestation, as the background risk was the same as compared to those who had the vaccine, even in the first trimester. I'm going to spend the next few minutes to further extrapolate the V-Safe registry. In the V-Safe registry, a small minority were vaccinated pre-conception, but one-third of women were vaccinated in the first trimester. So we now know that a vaccine did not cause miscarriage. However, three other similar studies showed similar outcomes. Was this paper by Mukherjee? Was the V-Safe registry and the Goldhaber test comparison showed that there were no increased risk of miscarriage following the vaccination as compared to the general population. And it was clear that the vaccine did not cause miscarriage. Similarly, ladies and gentlemen, they followed 1,634 women who were vaccinated and looked into four outcomes. Was there an increase in preterm delivery? No, it was not increased as compared to the general population. Was there an increase in small for gestational age? No. Was there an increase in neonatal ICU admissions? No. Was there an increase in infant deaths? There were no. There were no adverse outcomes following those who were vaccinated. Now, interestingly, another common question, does the vaccine cause stillbirth? They looked into all the mothers who were vaccinated and looked into the outcomes from December to July 2021. In fact, the incidence of stillbirth was higher in the unvaccinated group as compared to the vaccinated group. It is obvious perhaps they had an infection. But interestingly, only 26 babies in the vaccinated cohort had stillbirths, but it was not related to the vaccine. Let's take a look at the 26 babies in the cohort who actually had a stillbirth. 19% had placental complications not related to the vaccine. 18% had abruption and chorioamnionitis. 16% the mother had risk factors. One had CMV infection. One had multiple pregnancies. And these were the 26 stillbirths in the vaccine cohort, which is far lower than the background risk of 1 in 200. So it was clear the vaccine did not cause miscarriage. The vaccine does not cause stillbirth. So interestingly, ladies and gentlemen, those were the patients who were actually vaccinated in the first trimester. Now, how about those who were vaccinated in the second and third trimester? They followed them up as well, and they followed up and realized if this caused stillbirths or fetal anomalies. So interestingly, in the vaccination cohort, out of 1,574 mothers, only 45 infants had birth defects, and this was not increased as compared to the background population. The most common was heart and circulatory system, followed by musculoskeletal and genital abnormalities. But there were no increased risk of fetal anomalies in the vaccinated group as compared to the unvaccinated group. So ladies and gentlemen, recently a BJOC paper also looked into outcomes of those who were vaccinated in the third trimester and looked into delivery outcomes. There were no adverse effects with regards to APGAR score, mode of delivery, neonatal ICUs. Vaccinating in the first trimester is safe, second, third trimester is safe, near towards labor is safe as well. How about other vaccines? Just while I was preparing for this study, there's a paper that was just published 3 days ago, which looked into the safety of the AstraZeneca vaccine. Now, if you have the AstraZeneca vaccine during pregnancy, there was no increased adverse implications of fertility rates. It did not affect fertility rates. It did not affect pregnancy rates. And similarly, it did not cause increase in miscarriage. It did not cause increase in preterm deliveries. Most of the pregnancies were comparable as compared to the normal population. There is growing evidence that AstraZeneca is also safe, although the mRNA vaccine has got the best safety profile. Now, what about the vaccines? Does it have fetal benefits? We do know that influenza has got no fetal benefits, but Tdap vaccination. If you give Tdap vaccinations for all pregnant mothers, there's an increase in immunity levels, which is transmitted through the placenta and protects the fetus. Thus, vaccinating the mother with COVID-19 vaccine protects the fetus. Now, one of the first studies was this paper published in the ACOG, which looked into immunogenicity and reactogenicity. And they realized that the IgG was transmitted through the breast milk and the immune response was far higher following the vaccine as compared to someone who had a natural infection. That was an interesting fact. Similarly, this recent paper looking into antibodies in the breast milk, we followed up 6 subjects, realized that up to 40 days, there was significant high titers of antibodies in mothers who were vaccinated and who breastfed. And this we postulated may be associated with fetal benefits. Similarly, a recent JAMA paper by Estif Palau also looked into the quantification of antibodies in the breast milk and in the serum. And interestingly, the levels were comparable. So the amount of antibodies in the serum, in the umbilical cord, and in the breast milk were comparable and further strengthens the hypothesis that perhaps vaccinating pregnant mothers may be beneficial to the fetus. And that comes to the final question of this talk. Should we give booster or should we not give booster to pregnant mothers? So ladies and gentlemen, this recent paper published 5 days ago answers. This paper in the Lancet looked into the number that needs to be treated, and it is obvious that among the general population, among all cohort of people, the pregnant cohort had the lowest number that needed to be treated. The pregnant mother is COVID-19. To prevent a symptomatic infection, the number needed to treat is only 1 in 206. To prevent severe infections is 1 in 2,000 as compared to 1 in 7,000 in the general population. To prevent a preterm delivery is 1 in 200, one of the best interventions of preterm delivery prevention. And to prevent a cesarean section is 1 in 182. Thus, if you take a look at cost analysis and balance of benefit against risk, vaccinating pregnant mothers has got a lower number that needs to be treated, it's far beneficial. And that brings to the other fact about vaccine equity. If you have COVID-19 and you're resource-limited countries, the incidence of maternal death is far higher. More mothers died in Mexico from COVID-19 as compared to US. It's because of vaccine equity. There's going to be one intervention that is going to reduce the number of maternal deaths. It's the vaccine. If we had a good vaccine policy, we started earlier, we would have prevented 44% of maternal deaths in Asia. Now, I'd like to bring your attention to this wonderful new paper, which is going to strengthen the importance of giving boosters to pregnant mothers. It was a COVID mRNA vaccine looking into antibody profiles among mothers who are pregnant, mothers who are breastfeeding, and compare them with non-pregnant mothers. Interestingly, ladies and gentlemen, the antibody levels following a prime vaccine were lower as compared to antibody levels following a boosted vaccine. And this was significant among mothers who were pregnant, significant among lactating mothers as compared to non-pregnant mothers. So if you give a pregnant mother booster, the antibody rise was higher. The immunity was higher. The amount of antibodies transmitted to the breast milk was higher. And perhaps giving a booster does not only protect the mother, but also protects the baby, and further strengthens the hypothesis and the importance of giving boosters to pregnant mothers. So ladies and gentlemen, hence we came out with a guideline on the 13th of October, highlighting that pregnant mothers are vulnerable, recommending boosters for all pregnant mothers. If they had the vaccine 3 months before, they had 2 doses of Sinovac, the recommendation is to give Pfizer. It is safe. It can be given at any time. If the mother's concerned, you may give it after 12 weeks, but the vaccine does not cause miscarriage. If the mother had 2 doses of Pfizer, you can give a 3rd dose of Pfizer 6 months later. If the mother had 2 doses of AstraZeneca, you can give Pfizer. It is not contraindicated. Mixing vaccines from the COMCOV trial, the best combination of immunity is an AstraZeneca plus an AstraZeneca plus a Pfizer. You can mix vaccines, the protection and the booster is far better, as long as the mother had it beyond 6 months. What are the other guidelines that recommends booster? I believe with time, various other guidelines will be recommending, but as of now, the American College, the Society of MFM were one of the first guidelines to come out recommending boosters. This was followed by the Australian government and then the Malaysian government and then the CDC, who all now advocate boosters for all pregnant mothers. So to summarize, ladies and gentlemen, we should fear COVID-19, not the vaccine. No evidence does not mean it is unsafe. No evidence purely because pregnant mothers were neglected from studies and research. We should appreciate the physiological adaptations in pregnancy. The respiratory changes makes a mother more vulnerable. The cardiological changes, the immunity changes, that tallies with the severity of infection, that tallies with the effectiveness of the vaccine, that tallies with the hypothesis of boosters. I think as physicians, we should work on the science of probability. Giving vaccines is far more beneficial than the assumption and the perceived risk. The side effects are mild, transient, and reversible. It is clear that mRNA vaccines are safe. It is clear that any vaccine reduces deaths. We should be holistic, not be fetal-centric. It's our responsibility to save life of a mother, which is extremely precious. I would like to end with Prof. Mahmoud Fatala's quote, "Women don't die because of illnesses that we cannot treat. They die because society still hasn't decided that their lives are worth saving." Ladies and gentlemen, the implications of COVID-19 is significant. We should be protecting our mothers. Vaccination saves lives. Boosters are the way forward. With that, I would like to thank you so much for your attention. Now, I'd like to also promote an upcoming conference, the Malaysian Obstetric Medicine Scientific Conference, a hybrid conference coming your way. It's all about high-risk pregnancies. I'd like to thank you so much for your attention. If you do have any questions, I'll be more than happy to address them. Thank you so much, and please connect with us via www.obstetricmedicine.my.